Hello, I'm Simon Whistler. You're watching Today I Found Out, and in the video today, we're looking at how long would a person's heart have to be stopped before medics wouldn't try to revive them. Just before we get started, I do want to say that this video is brought to you by Hims. If you're a man who wants to take better care of himself, go to forhims.com/brainfood2 and try Hims today for just $5 while supplies last. Have you ever wondered how long a person's heart would have to be stopped before medics would stop trying to revive them? Well, subscriber of this channel, Ken Laha, reached out to us wondering just that, and we likewise are interested. So we sent this topic over to a paramedic friend of the channel, Scott, and he gave us his answer. So what Scott said was the question of how long someone's heart would have to be stopped before you can safely say that regardless of what you do, you're not going to be able to revive them is a very tricky one to answer. It's not as simple as saying after 10 or even 20 minutes, there's no hope. For instance, there are countless people who have been subject to hypothermia, have their heart stopped for over 45 minutes, and still have then been successfully revived. So many, in fact, that the current guideline set by the American Heart Association, AHA, is that you continue trying to revive the person until their core body temperature is above 95 degrees Fahrenheit, that's 35 degrees Celsius. This is because anything below that is the technical definition of hypothermia. The mantra in that situation is they're not dead until they are warm and dead. In other situations, numerous factors need to be considered when deciding when to stop trying to resuscitate someone, such as how quickly CPR was started after their heart stopped, how well CPR was performed, the types of medications used during the resuscitation, the medical history of the person, and finally, the cause of the cardiac arrest in the first place. With this in mind, let's take a quick look at some of the most common things to consider when trying to resuscitate someone and how long a medic would try to revive someone in that situation. The first and most important thing to consider is the point of trying to revive the heart in the first place. That's to supply the body, and most importantly, brain cells, with adequate blood flow. The first question any rescuer needs to consider is, what is the likelihood that the victim's brain cells are still functioning? If there's a good chance that if you get the heart going again, the person isn't going to be a vegetable, you continue trying. If not, you typically don't. For this, a general rule of thumb is that brain cells begin to die after approximately 4 to 6 minutes of no blood flow. After around 10 minutes, those cells will cease functioning and be effectively dead. That said, there are some exceptions to that rule. In situations of slow metabolism, like when a person is hypothermic, those time frames are extended. If good CPR is being performed, the brain cells are also getting some blood supply, although decreased, so the time frame is again extended to the point that the rescuer feels is appropriate. Now, the second thing you have to consider is what is the electrical function of the heart? The heart itself is a two-part pump. One part electrical, the other is plumbing. The electrical part is mediated by electrolytes like sodium, potassium, and calcium. The electricity created is what shocks the heart and causes it to contract and squeeze blood out to the body. Any rescuer needs some sort of electrical function to be happening within the heart to be able to get the heart beating on its own again. Whether they need to externally shock the heart, called defibrillation, or attempt to create a steady heartbeat externally, called pacing, they do need some electrical function. If there is some electrical function and good CPR was being performed, thereby continuing to get some blood to the brain, most will continue attempting to resuscitate. If no CPR was being performed, then possibly not. No blood flow would have been getting to the brain, and thus, after around 10 minutes, it would be futile in most cases. This is, of course, unless you were trying to perform resuscitation for the purposes of providing organ donation, then maybe it is worthwhile. Now, hopefully, at this point in the video, you're beginning to see why it's quite a tough question to answer. If there is good electrical function and it isn't creating a heartbeat, good CPR is being performed, then continuing to try and revive the individual would be a wise decision, even if it's been 45 minutes. That being said, there can be good electrical function and no heartbeat, called PEA, pulseless electrical activity. And if the rescuer feels it has been too long for the brain cells to survive, they might still decide to stop at 30 or even 20 minutes. From this so far, you might be thinking to yourself that it all comes down to the electrical function of the heart. If it's there, you continue. If it's not, you don't. Unfortunately, that's where this gets even more complex. Depending on what is happening electrically within the heart, there are medications and treatments that can be given in an attempt to put the heart in a better pulse-producing situation. So now let's have a look at those situations and talk about timings. The most common electrical rhythms that the heart can be in when it isn't beating are asystole, no electrical function, ventricular fibrillation, the heart is quivering, ventricular tachycardia, the bottom part of the heart is beating really fast, and PEA, which is anything that isn't one of the other three. Before we talk about the types of medications and treatments that can be attempted and the time frames, we need to emphasize that when someone is in cardiac arrest, the absolute best treatment known to man is good CPR compressions combined with early defibrillation. And do note here that contrary to popular belief, mouth-to-mouth isn't required or even advisable in most situations in order to have a good outcome, which is why the American Heart Association no longer recommends breathing for someone while performing CPR. As for why, we'll just say briefly it's not because of disease risk or anything of the sort, but because studies definitively show the person has a higher likelihood of surviving if you don't do it to them. This is even true for advanced medical personnel like paramedics or doctors. As to the why on that, that's a whole different can of worms that we're actually going to talk about in an upcoming dedicated video on this subject, but the important thing to bear in mind is there's no need to be nervous about mouth-to-mouth. Do hard compressions with a depth of about one-third of the width of the torso to the beat of the BG staying alive, and you may very well save a life. Now, do note here that no medication or treatment should ever be given in place of CPR and early defibrillation. That being said, if those two things aren't early enough, there are some things a rescuer could try. When it comes to the medications given, you have to take into account the time it takes for them to work. This will vary greatly depending on CPR compressions and numerous other factors, like normal time for that medication to be metabolized. So the times we give here are basically the best approximations that we currently have. So let's start with asystole. Currently, the AHA recommends using epinephrine or vasopressin combined with good CPR compression to circulate it. Epinephrine begins to cause reactions in about 1 to 2 minutes and begins to become less effective after around 5 minutes. The AHA thus recommends giving a dose every 5 minutes of resuscitation. You would continue trying to revive the victim with this drug until you felt the brain cells had no chance or you had no change in the electrical function of the heart. 20 minutes is a common time frame here. Vasopressin, though, that takes about 20 minutes to begin to cause a reaction. A rescuer would need to continue attempting resuscitation for at least that long before they would expect a result. 20 minutes would be then the minimum amount of time you would attempt resuscitation. Some would continue longer, especially if they had a change in the electrical function of the heart. Ventricular fibrillation and ventricular tachycardia are treated almost the same way. This is by externally shocking the heart. Along with epinephrine, the AHA also recommends giving amiodarone, and if that's not available, lidocaine. Amiodarone begins to work around 10 to 15 minutes, with lidocaine taking around 2 to 5 minutes. You would continue giving this drug until you reached its maximum dosage. With amiodarone, you use only one large initial dose, followed by a smaller dose should you get a heartbeat back. The time frame for this type of resuscitation can be quite long. This is because all of those treatments take time, and you could choose several different orders in which to give it. Essentially, you would start with shocking the victim, wait 2 minutes, then give epinephrine, wait another 2 minutes, then choose amiodarone or lidocaine, or any of the four, and then continue from there. As long as the person is still in this rhythm, you would continue. Should it change, you would then change your treatment. Scott does note here, by the way, that he has personally seen this rhythm persist for well over 30 minutes. Alright, then we get to PEA, which is pulseless electrical activity, as I mentioned before. This is its whole own animal, as it could be any sort of rhythm that isn't one of the others. Because of this, the gold standard is trying to fix the cause. For this, the AHA has a handy little mnemonic called the 6 H's and 5 T's. The 3 H's are hypovolemia, not enough blood, hydrogen ion, acidosis, hyperhyperkalemia, high or low potassium, hypoglycemia, low blood sugar, and hypothermia. The T's are toxins, either drugs or chemical, tamponade, cardiac tamponade, meaning fluid around the heart, tension pneumothorax, a hole in your lung that progresses in to put pressure on your heart, thrombosis, a clot or other occlusion in your blood vessels, and trauma. The treatment for each of those situations takes its own amount of time. Some take as little as 1 to 2 minutes, like in the case of fixing acidosis. A person could give a drug called sodium bicarbonate, or one could artificially breathe really fast for them. Some treatments can take well in excess of an hour, as in the case of fixing hypothermia. Things can get even more complicated should the victim begin to have several different heart rhythms. In those cases, and with most cases, it really comes down to whether or not the rescuer feels the brain cells are still viable. That decision is very subjective in nature. One doctor or paramedic might not choose to resuscitate someone when another would. Both could be correct in their decision depending on what they thought was the cause. With all of the specific treatments considered, it really comes down to brain cells. If they could still be viable, you would continue attempting resuscitation. If not, then you simply wouldn't. General timeframes that are common in hospitals and with paramedics are 20 to 40 minutes, should they choose to start resuscitation. But even within those timeframes, they might choose to not even try, depending on the situation. So in the end, we know the answer is not a concrete one, like 20 minutes, but hopefully this was at least an informative and interesting watch. As for Scott, he notes from his many years of personal experience that the longest he has ever personally seen a person's heart not beating and they were able to be successfully revived, meaning they walked out of the hospital with somewhat normal neurological function, was over 40 minutes. Luckily for that gentleman, he did have CPR started almost immediately and advanced life support was started within 12 minutes. So I really hope you enjoyed that video, and now I'd like to take a minute to tell you about Hims. Hims provides guys with real solutions to problems related to hair, skin, and other parts of the male body that don't work as great as they used to as we get older. Now, some things are not always easy to talk about, even with your doctor, which is probably why there are quite so many spam messages flooding my spam folder. But if you are looking for real solutions to the problems that men face as they get older, you do need to be aware of Hims. Now, it's an interesting fact, and it's one you might know, but men who are aged from 18 to 40 are the least likely group to visit a doctor or a pharmacy. But this doesn't mean we don't actually need those services. I mean, we're busy, we push problems out of our minds, and we just tend to try and get on with it. But we do face issues, hair loss, obviously, and some guys face skin issues, and even ED. Indeed, 26% of new cases of ED are men under 40. Now, the very fact that I am talking about this company is a testament to the fact that they're not some sketchy online pharmacy. Here at Today I Found Out, we are really careful about who we work with, and we really believe in what Hims is doing. Hims is a legitimate medical company. They send out what you get in these, it's always really nicely presented. They send it out every month. Medications, like I said, these are not potions, these are real medications that you get from an online consultation with a real doctor. They are always for scientifically proven medical grade drugs. Hims can improve many areas of your life, including your sex life, without expensive drugs, without awkward doctor's visits, and without all that waiting in line at the pharmacy. How it works is you head over to the website, you have a private consultation with a doctor, they'll recommend both prescription and non-prescription products tailored to your needs. You then pay a super reasonable price, no expensive brand medications, and then all of this is delivered to your door. Like I said, just because we don't like talking about some problems doesn't mean we shouldn't deal with them. Do yourself a favor, support this show by going to forhims.com/brainfood2 and try Hims today for $5 plus tax. See the website for full details, and thank you to Hims for sponsoring this video, and thank you for watching.